Hi, this could only be Rides with Chuck. I just got back from my annual visit with the B-17E Project Desert Rat. Mike Kellner, whose project this is, was very busy, but I did manage to get him in front of the camera for a few words. So Mike, it's 2019. Last time I was here was 2018. What all has been done in the last year?
Another year's gone by. We've been busy doing a lot of internal stuff on the fuselage, nose and cockpit, and then we're in the process of, we've stripped everything out of the bomb bay and redoing all of it.
It's all one big piece right now.
Yep, and we're hoping to get it all finished this year, at least all the metal work. Bomb bay is in progress right now. We have a lot of stuff at the machine shops that we're waiting for to get back. And hopefully we can reassemble it and be pretty much done with all the metalwork.
Mm-hmm. And the metalwork, what comes after the metalwork?
Then the systems, plumbing, wiring, all the knickknacks and the fun stuff.
Is that going to take as long as the metalwork?
I hope not. No, I don't think it'll take as long.
So that'll be the plans for next year, get it all together and...
It'll be partially that, then we're going to get back on the wings and try to get going on the metal work on the wings.
Okay, I was back there, they're taking rivets out of that wing. That wing doesn't look like it came from Desert Rat.
No, that was came off a wreck out of Yellowstone National Park that we had picked up.
Just started drilling it a little bit, haven't gone all the way through. You can tap it and sometimes break the base of the rivet off.
Yeah.
And something like that, what do you do with it? What do you get out of it?
There is good parts in there, but that can be made into a wing today, you know, and be kept as a spare.
I know it's pretty shredded.
Yeah. But, you know, almost anything can be made today. Mm-hmm. There's a few things that are a challenge, you know, like we're still looking for the wing spar tubing to be drawn and haven't overcame that yet. But
eventually we will.
As long as you've got you here, is there anything that you can... that is out there that you need that possibly somebody might say, hey?
Oh, lots of small parts. You know, once we get into the interior, you know, there's blocks and hinges and pulleys and brackets and seats and all that kind of stuff that we're looking for. More stuff for the armament, you know, gun mounts and turret parts. We've picked up a lot of the major stuff now this year, but now it's all getting down to a lot of little stuff.
It seems to be coming along pretty good. Huh?
We hope so.
Well, on that note, thanks for talking to us, Mike.
Thank you.
Okay, is there anything you want to add to that?
No, if anybody finds any B-17 parts or World War II parts, we're interested.
Are there any parts that are like universal that go on this plane and go on?
A lot of the instruments, you know, are the same. There are stuff that's common. Most of the oxygen system stuff's the same on all the airplanes.
I was looking at the device on the table over here.
Yeah, that's for a B-24. We thought it was for a B-17 at first, but some of that stuff gets used on certain models of this airplane and certain models of the other airplane, but it's not for an E model. So
you have to go by the VIN number, huh?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I was taking pictures of that. That's kind of neat.
Yeah.
Well, too bad you can't use it in your...
Right. Oh, we'll use it for trading or something.
Uh-huh.
So.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Thank you for coming today.
It's always a pleasure. It's always a pleasure. I visit Desert Rat on days when Warbird Squadron 4 is having a work day on the project. I spoke with Jerry, head of Warbird Squadron 4.
My role is I'm a member of, well, I'm actually now squadron commander of Warbird Squadron 4. We do a yearly trip out here to Marengo, usually in April, to help Mike with any part of the restoration work that he needs us to do.
When did all this start?
I've been probably coming out now 7-8 years doing this, and I think a couple of years prior to that the squadron was coming out, but I've been doing it about 7-8 years now.
Talk about Squadron 4. What exactly is Squadron 4?
Squadron 4 is affiliated with the EAA out of Oshkosh. The yearly air adventure they have out there. There's Warbirds of America. We're actually the Northern Illinois chapter, Squadron 4. We cover Northern Illinois, Southern Wisconsin. We have members all around the Midwest.
You have to have a warbird to belong to your group?
No, we don't. I'm the first squadron commander that is not a pilot. All the previous ones were pilots. I'm a big military aviation history buff. I just enjoy being around these warbirds and, you know, yeah.
On the project today, what are you going to be working on?
Well, I'm going to be helping the guys and ladies out and back. We're taking rivets off a wing section of a B-17, get down to the bare metal, save whatever pieces we can. So we're going to be out there, you know, taking the skin off the wing.
Why are you doing this?
Why? Because it's history. It's aviation history. It's World War II history. Mike really appreciates us coming out every year in April. Actually, last year we came out in October, so we did two trips last year. He just appreciates all the manpower, and I just think we get members to come out here and help. Where else can you go and actually do work and touch a B-17 and do something on a B-17? You know, that's just something you'll never do. I'm originally from, you know, Southside Chicago. I've always loved military history. My dad was a big military history guy. When I was little, I'd watch all the war movies and TV shows with him. I think that's where I got my interest into, you know, the military side. Never in the military. I just, you know, loved the history part all through grammar school, high school, even in junior college. I took all my history classes were military history classes. I just enjoy reading it, you know, living it and just experiencing it. And other things I do too is, besides Warbird Squadron 4, I'm actually the museum curator at Clow Airport, the Illinois Aviation Museum. So I became squadron commander 2 years ago, and he asked me 2 years ago to also become the volunteer museum curator. So I've been doing a lot of military stuff down there, getting stuff for the museum. Basically, history, Illinois history, and aviation history is what we're trying to put down in a museum.
What do you have to say to the people that are watching? There's going to be watching it on YouTube, the views all over the world. What do you have to say to them?
Just, you know, if you get a chance, you know, help out your local organizations that, you know, are doing either restoration work, get involved with any of the Warbird squadrons. I know there are other, like, EA chapters, but my love is Warbirds. They're all across the country. Help out, get involved. We try to do a lot of different things, you know, and I just think it's really neat to be around these planes. I got the opportunity to meet some World War II veterans, talk to them, you know, hear some of their stories. So any opportunity you get to, you know, talk to any of them, go see some of these warbirds flying, it's just, you know, it's just really an experience.
Thanks for talking to us, Jerry.
All right.
Thank you. Got it.
Take care. Okay.
Got it. One of the guys on the site today was the crew chief on another B-17, Aluminum Overcast. Well, being a crew chief, what is all involved with that?
We maintain the airplane and we fly with the airplane. There's always two crew chiefs with the airplane wherever we go. And we do all the maintenance on it and perform duties in flight as needed.
So what's it like being on that airplane?
The people you meet are just amazing. I've met Mr. Zamperini in Torrance, California. The airport's named after him, and I have a picture taken with him. I have a picture taken with Colonel Cole, who just passed away last week. Those people tell you stories that you don't hear anyplace else. Mm-hmm. And the World War II veterans that we met early on when I was doing this, you'd have 30 or 40. Now you get a handful.
I know I've met a number of them here. I put them on videos, mm-hmm. and I'm get it while you can.
And a lot of times you hear stories and their family will be standing there and they say, you know what, this is the first time I've ever heard that story. Good example. and we were in Rochester, Minnesota, and a ball turret gunner came out with his family, and they bought a ticket for the whole family. It was two daughters and his wife and him. And he didn't really want to go, but they got him on the airplane. When he got off, he had one of these little walkers that you can sit down on, got under the wing and started talking. And the last time he was on a B-17, he had to bail out. And he was in the doorway, and somebody shoved him out the door. So, and they said, we've never heard this. We've never heard this story. You know, just amazing people. About 2 weeks ago, I gave a talk to the DuPage Pilots Association about the tour, and covered some of the experiences we've had with that. Interesting, very interesting. It's real rewarding when you meet the families of people that have been involved in the airplane.
Thanks for talking to us, Glenn.
All right.